people call me an audiologist. Others call me a hearing nerd. Being human with hearing loss is like my superpower. As a hearing doctor, I get to help people hear their best while learning about the mysteries of hearing. Humans, welcome back to Dr. Rose Helps You Hear. I'm Stephani Rose, and today we're going to simulate what it's like to have a high-frequency hearing loss. So in a moment, I'm going to show you what the audiogram looks like, or the shape of the hearing loss, and what portions of speech this really affects. But first, I want to say thank you so much for watching my channel. If you have any desires for certain videos, please drop a comment below in the video. And also, don't forget to hit that subscribe button so I know that you like my videos and that you want me to keep going. Thank you so much for watching. Okay, so here is the audiogram with a high-frequency hearing loss. You can see that this starts off in the normal range, so this goes from soft to loud and then low pitch to high pitch like a piano. The O is representative of a right ear, but we're gonna assume that both ears have this symmetrical type of high-frequency hearing loss. So on here you see we have the speech banana. These are the average sounds of speech. So when someone's talking at an average conversation level, where these letters, or really speech sounds, or phonemes as they're called, wind up on the audiogram on average according to the volume and the frequency of that given speech sound. So you can see here, everything that is below this line, the person with high frequency hearing loss hears just fine with their natural hearing. So the portions of speech that are missing are the high frequency sounds that really have no voicing. So you can feel on your throat when you produce these sounds that your vocal folds do not vibrate. So they're very quiet sounds. It's really just air moving across your teeth and lips. And unfortunately, these are the clarity sounds of speech. So when you have a high frequency hearing loss, you might start to feel like people are mumbling, you might complain that people are not speaking as clearly, and you might be really cranking up that volume on the TV because you're just trying to get that clarity. It's not that you don't hear the volume. The volume areas are where you do well, the clarity sections are where you need help. So just to demonstrate what I mean by that, it's the difference between cat versus fat versus sat versus pat versus hat, etc. So you might get, you know, one word kind of incorrect, and then you're having to backtrack in your mind, putting the context together, looking at people's lips helps. And that's where hearing aids can help move these sounds up to where you do hear them. And as long as your nerve is not horribly affected, then we get this clarity of speech through a hearing aid. This shape we would call normal, sloping to moderate, almost moderately severe, but it's still within that moderate category when it's catching at 60 dBHL, so decibels hearing level. So next I'm gonna show you what it's like to hear a conversation through this hearing loss, and then I'm gonna switch to normal hearing so that you can hear that clarity come through. Okay, so here's a conversation between a man and a woman. If you saw my other hearing loss simulation with the reverse slope loss, it's the same conversation, and I will try to caption this for you guys as well. So here it is, first through the hearing loss, and then I will switch to normal hearing so you can hear that clarity come through. But do take note that it's going to sound pretty mumbly and pretty muffled. Here we go.
Okay, so you're not gonna be able to do this. Is that what you're telling them?
I'm telling you, that's probably what I'm gonna do.
Oh, you're just gonna sit here and listen?
Yeah.
Tell me about work. How was your day?
I don't wanna talk about work. I'm not gonna talk about work, the better I feel, especially on my day.
Okay.
So you're not gonna be able to do this. Is that what you're telling them?
I'm telling you, that's probably what I'm gonna do, is not do it.
You're just gonna sit here and listen?
Yes.
Tell me about work. How was your day?
I don't want to talk about work. The less I talk about work, the better I feel, especially on my day off.
Back to the loss.
Okay.
So you're not going to be able to do this. Is that what you're telling them?
I'm telling you, that's probably what I'm going to do.
You're just going to sit here and listen?
Yeah.
Tell me about work. How was your day?
I don't want to talk about work. The less I talk about work, the better I feel, especially on my day off.
One more time for normal.
Okay. So you're not going to be able to do this. Is that what you're telling them?
I'm telling you, that's probably what I'm going to do, is not do it.
You're just going to sit here and listen?
Yes.
Tell me about work. How was your day?
I don't want to talk about work. The less I talk about work, the better I feel, especially on my day off.
Okay,
so that was the simulation of the normal, sloping to moderate, almost moderately severe, high frequency, essentially sensory neural or inner ear hearing loss. So I'm going to explain how that happens. Now, we can have high frequency hearing loss for a variety of causes and reasons, the most common being age-related hearing loss. So why does that happen? As sound comes into your ear canal, it vibrates on the eardrum. The eardrum sends those vibrations down this little chain of middle ear bones to the inner ear, where we actually have the organ of hearing called the cochlea. Inside of the cochlea, we have little hair cells or cilia that vibrate or sense those vibrations through the fluid that's in the cochlea, and then they trigger an action potential along the hearing nerve to tell your brain what you hear. So it's actually a very complex process. But all sound throughout our whole lives have to go through the cochlea the same way. But the cochlea is tuned from high pitch to low pitch in the center. So all sound, no matter if it's high or low pitch, has to go through those high pitches to get to where they need to go before they get sent to the brain. So those high pitches or high frequency hair cells tend to wear down with time, age, and noise exposure. So we really can't avoid high frequency loss. Even quiet tribes in Papua New Guinea that have no industrial noise exposure wind up with a mild to moderate high frequency hearing loss at the end of the lifespan. So that's why it's so important that you get diagnosed and treat your hearing loss so that you can maintain the clarity of speech for as long as possible. We want to prevent something called auditory deprivation, where we just let the hearing loss, if we let the hearing loss stay without any hearing aids, we can have a loss of clarity over a long period of time. When someone has high frequency hearing loss due to age over time, we lose it little by little, and we may not notice that it's happening. So some of the signs are people saying, huh, what, come again? So increased recall or request for repetition of speech. The other thing you might notice is that the TV volume is creeping up and up. And this isn't because it's a volume problem, it's a clarity problem. And again, hearing aids can help with this. When we're communicating with someone who has high frequency hearing loss, it's very important that we show our face, show them our lips, don't turn away while you're talking. And also don't walk away while you're talking, because then the sound waves are channeled elsewhere and not to the person's ears. We also want to slow down our speech. If you're having to deal with a sensory loss, it's very hard to decode that signal once it reaches the brain. So it does take someone with hearing loss of any kind a little more time to decipher the signal when it has to go through a damaged auditory system or an auditory system that's not properly working. The other thing that we can do is separate our words. So if we articulate and enunciate properly, then the sounds can come through a little bit crisper and a little bit clearer, rather than having something called co-articulation. Co-articulation is where our vowel spaces start predicting the next word's vowel spaces, and they all run together. And we've all experienced a young person speaking quickly, and this is happening, and it's very hard to tell which words they're saying. So advocate for yourself. Say, I'm sorry, did you say to get a bat at the store? And then the person should repeat word for word exactly what they said. No, I said a mat. And then you want to reiterate or repeat, we need a new welcome mat for the front door. That way the person with hearing loss gets the information twice in different scenarios or of words, and it might be more clear to them, and better, they will be better able to obtain that information. So I hope that that was helpful for these hearing tips. In a future video, I'm going to go over the cognitive effects of hearing loss and how this can impact our brain. Thank you so much for watching Dr. Rose Helps You Hear. I hope to see you again in my next video. And thank you so much for subscribing. It helps me to know that I'm doing a great job. I hope you have a great rest of your day and stay well out there.